If you're visiting, thank you for joining with us this morning. Beautiful day out, a beautiful day to come together. I want to introduce Twyla Glidewell to you. I believe she'll probably be in second service, but she would like to be identified as a member of this congregation. Recently moved our way from Mount Vernon, Missouri, and is currently living down in Spring Hill temporarily, and then she'll be moving, I believe, to maybe it's a Bucyrus address. But be sure to meet Twyla. She's recently widowed after 61 years of marriage, so quite an example there for us, and make her acquaintance, please. You may be interested in how we handle when someone wants to place membership. Maybe you don't even think about that, but some people do. But what we've been doing recently, when someone tells us they want to place membership, the elders and usually the preachers try to meet with them. Maybe not all of us. That's quite a crowd these days. But at least meet with the person, answer any questions they have, get to know them a little better, and then they get to know us. And then we announce to the congregation. And we've sort of got a backlog right now. Several families or people have indicated their desire to be members of this congregation and get involved and work with this congregation. So we're trying to get those scheduled. And with schedules the way they are, sometimes it's difficult. But it's a good problem to have. But anyway, that is the way we work it. And sometimes it takes us 3 or 4 weeks to get with folks. But that's what we are trying to accomplish. When a preacher presents a sermon on a particular topic, the congregation doesn't always know, or maybe doesn't even really care, why he chose that particular topic for that particular Sunday. As long as it is a biblical topic and helps you live a faithful Christian life, that's probably all you care to know in most cases. And usually, I don't make any effort to identify or to explain why I have chosen the topics that I have chosen. I just hope that you recognize them as being useful. But today, I do want to tell you why I have decided to present a short series of lessons on the general topic of discernment. Maybe just knowing the development of my idea may help it, may help make the idea clearer or more relevant for you. Several years ago, I decided that I wanted to develop one or a few lessons on this topic of discernment and discernment and decisions. And I'm just now getting to that note in my sermon idea file. But the original idea came from an observation of churches, and particularly of some churches that I thought were headed in wrong directions. But I soon realized that what I saw as a problem for congregations could also be a problem for individual Christians. The problem lost my place there. The problem wasn't simply that some churches decided to do things, and it was that they decided to do things and then went in the direction that they needed to go in to get where they decided to go, to be the type of congregation they wanted to be. I saw some churches adopt unscriptural practices, and it appeared that they knew exactly what they were doing. They wanted to become a certain kind of church, and they made the decisions that would take them in that direction. They chose a destination and then took the path that would get them to where they wanted to be. That's a problem in itself, but that's not exactly what I want to talk about this morning. Because I saw other churches head in the same questionable directions, but there was a difference. They were simply following fads and trends that they had observed, or were accepting church growth theories that they had seen other churches apply. They weren't intentionally trying to become a particular kind of church, but they were headed in that direction anyway. So contrary to the congregations that had chosen a destination and then took the path that would get them there, these congregations just picked a path and didn't realize where it would take them. The problem was that, at least in my opinion, they didn't think through where the changes they were implementing would take them. It was a lack of discernment. Whether my evaluation of those trends and outcomes is accurate or not, that's another matter. But the thought process, or the lack thereof, impressed on me the importance of discernment. The same goes for each and every Christian. We must use discernment. We might call it by different terms. We might call it just common sense. We might call it good judgment. Maybe clear-headedness. But good-hearted, well-intentioned Christians get in trouble when their hearts and their intentions aren't supported by good discernment. We've all done things that weren't too bright, and after the fact, we admitted that we weren't really thinking. And that's an accurate description of a lack of discernment. We do something, we aren't trying to do something wrong, but we don't think it through. I was 7 or 8 years old, and a group of us boys was taking turns standing up against the side of an old wooden coal shed in our backyard, and the other guys would throw the darts. Now, you might want to cover children's ears so that they don't get ideas from this. But it was like at the circus where the knife thrower throws the knife as close as he can to the head of the lady standing against the board without hitting her. And that's exactly what we were doing, but with sharp, steel-pointed darts. Fortunately, no one lost an eye. But if something had gone wrong, or even if something hadn't gone wrong and our parents had found out about it, my parents would have asked, "What were you thinking?" And I would have answered, "I guess I wasn't." It is a part of being an immature child to lack discernment and not think things through. But as we grow, maturity implies better discernment. As Christians mature, we need to grow in discernment in spiritual matters. We shouldn't accept doctrines or follow religious trends and fads without careful discernment. We're not going to get into a study of Greek words this morning, so unless you want to look this up on your own, you'll just take my word for this. But there are only a small handful of Greek words used in the New Testament, probably 6 words at most, that convey the idea of discernment and are sometimes translated discernment. Your English Bible probably doesn't use the word discernment more than a dozen times, if that many. And those dozen times don't all come from the same Greek word, and the words translated discernment are sometimes translated with other words. A sampling of the options, though, would be discern or judge, examine, test, prove or approve, be sober-minded, and possibly a few more. So even if the word discern isn't used all that often, this group of words that convey the same idea is used very often. In addition to discernment and its synonyms, there are other words that suggest or that call for discernment. Every time the Bible says beware, the writer is calling the readers to use discernment. Every time the Bible says, don't be led astray, don't be deceived, they are calling for discernment. In the end, every decision we make, good or bad, involves some discernment. It happens so often that we really need to pay attention to it. We're going to have 3 lessons on this general idea, or at least I think there will be 3. Today, I just want to do an overview of the different context in which discernment is applied in Scripture. Next week, we'll look more at Bible examples where people discerned or didn't. And the 3rd lesson, we'll look more at the importance of the decisions we make. Decisions change lives, so we need to use great discernment in our decisions. The New Testament book of Hebrews was first written to Christians who had been Jews. In fact, many of them were still Jews. We know from the early chapters of the book of Acts that for a while, even the apostles lived with one foot in Judaism and one foot in Christianity. They still went to the temple for the hours of prayer. They still went to the synagogues on Sabbath. They still abstained from certain foods because those were prohibited under the old law. They didn't make, nor did they require others to make, a clean break from Judaism. Even the big discussion about circumcision wasn't about whether Jewish converts could, if they wanted to, continue to follow Jewish practices, just that they were not allowed to require Gentiles to do the same. As time went by, it became more difficult and less desirable to be both Christian and Jew at the same time. For many years, Judaism had been a permitted religion in the Roman Empire, and the Romans considered Christians to just be a new sect of Judaism. So the church benefited from the legal umbrella of Judaism. But by the time the book of Hebrews was written, all of this was changing. The Jews were openly revolting against Rome. Armed revolt was underway. The Christians were less and less linked in the minds of people with Judaism. But as the older and seemingly more predominant, more established religion, it appeared to some Jewish Christians that if they had to make a choice, it might be best to stick with Judaism. There was a decision to make, and it would require discernment. The book of Hebrews was written to help to show those people that had those doubts that Christianity was the best choice. Now, these people knew Judaism. They knew about Judaism. They had abundant information about Judaism. They also had a good understanding of Christianity, though maybe a little bit less developed than their understanding of Judaism. But they were going to have to take their knowledge of Judaism and take their knowledge of Christ and the gospel and through discernment make a clear choice. In that context, the writer of Hebrews writes, "For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." By now, these folks should have been thoroughly convinced that Christ offered more and better benefits than Old Covenant Judaism. This should have been an easy choice for them. Now today we sometimes maybe oversimplify the limitations of Judaism with the food restrictions and all the sacrifices and all that. But from our vantage point, this is an easy choice for us. The gospel is clearly more attractive than Judaism. For them, the decision wasn't that easy. And the writer points out that it should have been easier for them than it was. The reason it was still a difficult choice for some was that they had not matured to the point of being able to discern between the two. And this book was written to help them think it through. For the next couple of minutes, we're just going to skim through the book of Hebrews and look at some statements where the need for discernment is most evident. In chapter 2, verse 1, we have a good example. Verses 1, 2, and 3. "Therefore, we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proves steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard Him?" Notice the key words: give earnest heed, and lest we drift away. And he then calls them to discern between what was impressive because it had been spoken by angels and what was even more impressive because it had been spoken by Christ, the Son of God. Something Jesus said trumps something an angel said, and discernment would tell them that. In the following chapter, in chapter 3, verses 12 and 13, he uses the word beware to highlight the need for discernment. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. If there were nothing they could do about it, the warning to beware was useless. His call to beware implies that by discernment they could make a good choice. It would help if they would exhort one another. If they didn't exhort each other, and if they didn't beware, then they would fall to the deceitfulness of sin. Sin deceives, but by discernment, informed and exhorted Christians could identify the deception and withstand the temptation. There are several examples like these sprinkled clear through the book of Hebrews, but we'll settle for just one more example, this from the well-known chapter 11. Chapter 11, beginning in verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked to the reward. What did Moses do? He looked at being a prince of Egypt, and he looked at his eternal reward. He looked at the benefits of being a prince, and he looked at the benefits of suffering along with the people of God. Choosing between the two options was an act of discernment. Clearly, discernment was important for Moses and for the entire history of Israel in this case. Different discernment words are used in a wide variety of applications in the New Testament. The very first New Testament use of the word discernment is in an illustration by Jesus himself. In Matthew chapter 16, the Pharisees and Sadducees were challenging Jesus, and they asked him for a sign. They wanted a sign or a miracle from him to prove that the time for the Messiah to come had come and that he was indeed the Messiah. Jesus pointed out that they could discern the weather by looking at the sky, but they hadn't been able or willing to discern who he was by the miracles he had already done for them. Matthew chapter 16 verses 2 and 3, he answered and said to them, "When it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times." His answer implies that they could have made a good decision based on the available evidence. It was their lack of discernment that stood in the way. In other words, if they would look at his ministry, think it through in light of the scriptures they knew, they would have made a better decision. One of the best known discernment passages is one we often read right before the Lord's Supper, coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. The subject is the Lord's Supper, and particularly the Corinthian perversions of the Lord's Supper, and that is set in the overall context of the divisions and problems in the Corinthian church. A major problem was a failure to appreciate the relationships between members of the body of Christ in the church in light of the crucified body of Christ. And in this passage, Paul actually uses several different discernment words. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning verse 28, down through 31. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. In verse 28, we have the word examine, which is one of the discernment group of words. In this verse, he wants a Christian to discern or to examine himself. But then in verse 29, he says that they were participating in an unworthy manner because they were not discerning the Lord's body. And the result was that they were drinking judgment on themselves. And judgment is another of the discernment word group. The message was that if they would think through the purpose and the implications of Christ's body being crucified, and the bringing together of saved people in the spiritual body of Christ, the church, then they wouldn't be having the problems that they were having. Were they supposed to be thinking about the Lord's physical body during the Lord's Supper? Or were they supposed to be thinking about the spiritual church body? Or were they supposed to be thinking about their role as a member of the body? Well, it was all of the above. They were to discern, to examine, to evaluate, to appreciate the relationships they had with Christ, in the body of Christ, and with each other because of the sacrifice of His physical body. Part of discernment is taking the information or the doctrines of the Bible and thinking about what those doctrines mean in our lives. Let's stay with the Lord's Supper for a moment. Do you ever struggle with what exactly should you be thinking about during the Lord's Supper? Is it the cross? Or is it the church? Should you open your Bible and meditate on a crucifixion passage, or be looking over the words of a good Lord's Supper hymn? The New Testament doesn't give us a set of bullet points that we are required to think about or to recite every time as we observe the Lord's Supper. But we are called to think through in various ways to discern what Jesus did and how it should change our lives. We discern when we take the information and work through it for a faithful response. In Luke chapter 12, Luke tells of a conversation similar to the one that Matthew recorded about discerning the weather by looking at the sky. In Luke chapter 12, verse 56, Jesus said, "Hypocrites, you can discern the face of the sky and of the earth, but how is it you do not discern this time?" Luke uses a different word for discern than Matthew had used, but they both mean the same thing, and so they've both been translated with the word discern. But Paul then uses that same word when he wrote Romans 12, verse 2, that we know very well. "And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." When he says, "that you may prove," that is another translation of "that you may discern." The NIV translates that as "that you may test and approve." The English Standard has "that by testing you may discern what is the will of God." We could do a whole series of lessons, of course, on this passage from Romans. But simply said, we are to think through the differences between being conformed to the world and transformed by Christ And that discernment will help us understand what pleases God. We'll probably come back to this idea in a later lesson, this idea of using discernment to resist conforming to the fads and trends that we see around us. As Paul was wrapping up his letter, his first letter to the Thessalonians, he called for discernment. This is what he wrote in 1 Thessalonians 1, verses 21 and 22. Test all things, hold fast what is good, abstain from every form of evil. The holding fast to the good and the abstaining from evil were made possible by the testing of all things. Testing doesn't mean that we have to take a personal sample of good and evil to see which one we enjoyed the most. The word testing is the word for discerning. We don't have to try them out to discern which is from God and which isn't from God. I don't have to try adultery to know that it's wrong. But someone might challenge you by saying, well, how do you know it's sin if you haven't tried it? Well, the answer is, we know that it is wrong by discernment. That's why we discern, so that we can figure it out. The last general context for discernment that we'll look at today is in not being deceived. Satan is the deceiver. He sends false teachers to deceive. False teachers dress lies up to look like truth. Temptations deceive because they are so attractive. And we even deceive ourselves. As we saw earlier in the book of Hebrews, having information is helpful, but it's not enough all by itself. Jewish Christians had plenty of information about Judaism and about the gospel. What they needed was discernment to check the value of each one and then make a good choice. For example, information would tell us, love your neighbor. Discernment would convince us that loving our neighbor is better than not loving him. Discernment would also help us figure out the best ways to demonstrate that the love we have for our neighbor. One of the more revealing mentions of discerning or thinking things through is in Galatians 6, verse 7. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. Discernment looks at the outcome of going a certain direction. Discernment looks at the wide path, it looks at the narrow path, and it considers where each one will take us. We deceive ourselves when we decide that a certain behavior may be sin and it usually leads to bad things, but I will be the exception. It won't hurt me. Discernment is a powerful tool for avoiding this kind of self-deception. Now, I know that this lesson has been more theoretical than practical, and Lord willing, next Sunday we'll look at examples of people in the Bible who were discerning and who made good decisions, and examples of people who were not discerning and made bad decisions. And there are lots of both kinds of examples. Anytime someone had to make a choice between two options, discernment came into play. Sometimes they had to discern between sin and righteousness, other times simply between good and better. But today I just wanted to give an overall idea of how pervasive the subject of discernment is in Scripture and in our lives. We may be very aware of it, though, without even having put a name on it. So maybe now, as we read these passages and other passages in the future, we'll recognize that discernment is involved here, and discernment plays a major role in our Christian lives. Sometimes people sin because they're tempted, and the temptation is so appealing that they truly prefer sin. But in other cases, we sin because we are led astray because we weren't thinking. This is something that I think about often in preaching. And I don't know if I succeed in this or not, but I guarantee you I try. I try hard at it. When I prepare and present a lesson, I am not trying to answer all of your questions on a topic. And I am not, I am not trying to make your decisions for you. I'm much more concerned with helping and encouraging you to think. We can't have a preacher or an elder with us every minute of every day telling us this is wrong, this is right. We need to be a thinking people. We have to take what we see, take what we hear, and discern. Somewhere along the line, if you are a Christian, you became a Christian because you used discernment. Maybe you were a non-Christian adult, or maybe you had grown up in a faithful Christian family and became a Christian at a young age. But at some point, you had enough awareness to look at who you were and where you were in life, and you could see that God wanted you to go in a new direction. You looked at the options, you look at what Christ did and what He offers, and you evaluated the options, you used discernment, and you made a decision. Or you didn't make a decision, which in fact was a decision. But if you haven't discerned and decided that you want what Christ offers, think it through again. Be discerning, and you take the path that leads you to eternal life. If you need help, if you need the prayers of the church to grow in willingness and ability to discern better, we'll help you however we can. Think about it and do what the Bible tells you to do. Confess your faith in Christ, turn from sin, and be baptized into Christ. If we can help you this morning, let us know. Let's stand and sing.